And now trains, or to be more precise, the train that was to have been the brightest of them all, the advanced passenger train. Almost 40 miles an hour faster than the ordinary high-speed trains. In fact, it's failed. Like other brave new British inventions, we couldn't quite get right.
Alone and immobile in a Glasgow loco shed, the biggest question mark of all hangs over the APT. Tomorrow's train is now yesterday's train, tomorrow maybe. Only Hornby makes it work. Even their sales are depressed because of British Rail's failures. For the APT, time is running out. Back in the 60s, it was talk of super trains. Railway technology, we were told, would revolutionize our lives. But now, behind the futuristic nose cone, technical problems will simply not go away. Problems that led 16 months ago to the APT's humiliating withdrawal from service.
Very tough train, there. And two taps. One is a rough tap and one is a fine tap. So it's a rough tap.
Underneath it all, problems that go to the roots of how the project was researched, funded and executed.
I see the beginning of it, not the end.
For some who worked on APT, it's the end of the line.
We wanted to give passengers a comfortable ride. That was the first criteria. A comfort of ride which was independent of speed, and that we could, we hoped, reach speeds well in excess, maybe by a factor of two, over the maximum that was then available, 70 miles an hour, so that point-to-point timing, for business people in particular, and others, could be shortened dramatically. Now that was the vision I had, and it seemed to me, beyond question, something which, if succeeded, would give a new look entirely to railways and present railways as something which was more in keeping with modern requirements and modern and competition with alternative modes of transport.
It's very difficult, I think, to put one's finger on exactly what has gone wrong, but I think the largest thing missing from the programme was the failure to take a large, deep breath at the end of the research phase.
Such was the self-confidence at that juncture that British Rail went really rather over the top on the promotional front. There were APT luggage labels, APT ties for the men, APT scarves for the ladies, APT writing paper, and an APT ballpoint pen. Very useful, I suppose, for the tilt. But all these items proved in the event very unhappy hostages to fortune.
The brakes were binding, causing serious overheating. The new transfer gearboxes had lubrication problems, which have not yet been finally resolved. Bolts on the axles had a tendency to work loose, BR admitted to one derailment. And the very basis of APT technology, the tilt, had a design problem. If it failed at full tilt, it would lock there, discomforting passengers and promoting the possibility, however remote, of a collision with another APT at full tilt. The HST, the diesel high-speed train, once little more than a stopgap for the arrival of APT, now British Rail's flag carrier. It may not tilt, but it does most of the other things expected of trains. A new electric version of this engine might even haul the APT. If it does see service, the APT will be introduced on BR's West Coast route. It would concentrate on cutting journey times to Manchester and the Northwest. And the 100-mile-an-hour trains now travelling the West Coast route would finally be retired. For the government to agree to that investment, a lot of scepticism will have to be overcome. The Department of Transport has recently commissioned consulting engineers to report on the railways. Chris Holland.
On the evidence known to me, I think it would be quite wrong at the present time to invest in 20 sets of APTs. What is needed, as we have recommended in our study, is a considered assessment of the alternatives for future traction requirements on the West Coast Main Line.
Cyril Bleasdale became director of Intercity a year ago. He will be backing the APT application.
Well, it's going to require a lot of persuasion, but then we usually find when we go to the government, everything requires persuasion. And it also requires some vision. And it also requires some understanding that it's our customers that we're serving. And we know from our experience with the high-speed trains, after all, we run 260 high-speed trains a day at 125 miles an hour. And we know that based on their success, that reduced journey times is a thing that we can sell to our customers. It's a thing we want. So the APT is something of a vision. It's going to require some persuasion because it's got an unhappy history based on three meagre prototypes.
Would it be terrible news, catastrophic news, for Intercity and your empire if Department for Transport turned around and said, no, you can't have the money?
A disappointment? We'd try again.
Another British engineering feat off the rails.
Annoyingly, of course, others have succeeded where we have not so far. The French train de grande vitesse runs from Paris to Lyon at speeds of up to 185 miles an hour. Its fastest was 237 mph, and that's a world record. It averages the speed that the APT was supposed to be doing. But to be fair, there's one difference, and that's the amount of money that the French government put into their project. The British taxpayer put in £50 million, the French spent 17 times as much, £850 million, and built a brand new track for the high-speed train only. But who knows, if all our teenage tycoons working away on their home computers were to put their minds to it, they might just find a technical answer for the poor old APT. But would the hard-headed little businessmen put their profits into it?